Welcome to the Vine Resources Podcast Show with your host, David Lawrence.
Welcome to another edition of the Vine Resources Podcast Show. Well, look, today I'm delighted to have with us on the line from New York, Sean Pedersen. Sean is the founder and CEO of Strongarm Tech. Sean, thanks for joining us.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me.
Sean, you've got an amazing company. I mean, really, really interesting stuff that you're doing. I don't want to steal your thunder, but I'd love you to share with our listeners all about your company and what you're doing, please.
Yeah, absolutely. Strongarm Tech is a safety science company. And what our goal is to keep every industrial athlete, every blue-collar worker around the world, proud, protected, and productive. The way that we do that today is with sensors and with big data. And what we do is we have a proprietary wearable that is essentially measuring a whole bunch of complicated risk factors and delivering insights to the individual to help avoid injury in real time. What we typically deliver is about a 50% injury reduction year over year. So that's, you know, if you look at the duration of this call alone, we'll have about 30,000 people go home hurt, about 2,500 people die on the job around the world just for putting bread on the table. And our goal is to help avoid those. And at right now, at a 50% strike rate, that means, you know, 50% of people going home to their kids at night. And that's what our business is all about. We take those insights from driving that risk, and now we drive it into the ecosystem, and we find operational insights to help organizations use risk to and use our insights to help navigate around risk. And that's the notion of what we're doing, is we found that there's a truly unique asset of being able to monitor these individuals to keep them safe, and then find the nuances inside of the business, the pitfalls that haven't been picked up, and apply that back to the industrial athlete and rebalance the inequity that's been going on, because trillions of dollars a year spent on this is an epidemic. And the fact that there is not a high level of attent to it is frustrating. And that's why we're here.
Yeah, I mean, that's really amazing. And you know, this is the stuff you'd normally think of still is happening in the future, but it's here right now. I was going to say, there's so many knock-on effects from the work that you're doing. How does it benefit? Apart from the fact that you're saving lives and helping people lengthen their life, but how is it impacting the day-to-day operational of those businesses that you're supporting as well, and also the workers?
Sure. It's really a win-win scenario. And I think that's what we had to go for when we started the business, right? With numbers that significant in terms of the billions of dollars we've spent, you'd think that there would be a slightly larger pool, right? And what we thought it was when we started the business was that no one cared, right? And human lives were a cost of doing business. The truth is, what we learned as we developed new technologies and embedded them, it's not a lack of care, it's a lack of understanding. These injuries happen fast, and Strongarm needs to be faster. So being able to collect the insights allows us to automatically eliminate those injuries. But what we're doing in that time is we're also taking that complex risk science. Our chipset has over 25 different sensing inputs. It collects at a rate of 12 and a half times a second. We collect more data than an environmental health and safety professional could collect in a 40-year career, measuring 7 days a week. We collect that much data in 2 days. So the scale and what we're doing is impactful, but driving the injury cost down alone isn't enough to get organizations to care. But because we have such breadth of data, and it's such in a time series database, it allows us to get forensic around those operational insights. So where our business started was driving insights to just eliminate the injury. But now what we're finding is that there's a proliferation of technology inside of the warehouse. COVID has made that such. There are cameras now. Things are getting to a big brother aspect. And what we're doing as a business is addressing that. And what we're saying is proud, protected, and productive doesn't just mean from the work. It also means from the operations, right? How can we prevent this data, the proliferation of this new data, Industry 4.0, from going down and being punitive against that industrial athlete, right? And that's where we come in. You know, everything inside of a warehouse, thanks to Industry 4.0, is monitored, except for the most precious conduit of it all, the industrial athlete. So what we're doing is we're finally understanding and helping businesses learn that if you can measure it, you can manage it. And what we want you to do is manage your employees, not by punitive metrics, but rather use our information to help them navigate around risk to increase operations. So what does that mean for the business? Well, if we're reducing injuries at a rate of 45% year over year, that's an 8-to-1 ROI. That means every dollar a client gives us, they're going to get $8 back. And that savings comes in from people not getting hurt. Now, as we kind of draw that scale further, our devices are on the bodies of everyone inside of a location, a facility, whether it be a warehouse or construction facility. We are there and we're monitoring. We know where they are in terms of risk, congestion. With COVID, we're able to understand how to keep people socially distant. So we're able to keep operations fuller and running safer while also maintaining the pace that they need during this peak season. So all in all, what we found is that if you can use our data to help manage and inform that workforce, you actually can find insights that allow you to drive that person's work day based on their own physiology and not just based on the numbers you need. So we're able to actually inform a safer workforce, and what is yielded is a less fatigued workforce. And that less fatigued workforce not only is less likely to get an injury, but they're also actually increasing productivity and throughput. So where our business is taking a transition is that we've collected over 35,000 users worth of data and driving true insights by finding a new paradigm in safety. And now that's what we're doing. We're re-envisioning and repainting a roadmap as to how we value labor. And we're finding that connection because we think that it's inextricably linked, the performance, the safety, and the throughput of an organization. And the only conduit that makes any sense right now for us is a score that can manage the way employees can perform at their best while also being safe.
It's amazing. And how do you see this, how do you see your solutions helping a wider audience, in the future? Do you see it being used in other areas?
Yeah, absolutely. And where it comes down to is following the trail of risk. So we work with the five largest work comp insurers. The work comp insurers are directing us to where they see those buckets of risk. And what that allows us to do is drive from a parallel market into a new vertical. So we essentially started the business looking for statistical density and repeatability. So we went to manual materials handling workers. We had over 20,000 manual materials handling workers. These are guys handling boxes, moving in the back of your warehouse at the Amazon facility and packing the truck, right? The reason we went for that is because it's so similar in all of these actions, and we're able to essentially rewrite the book of risk in those environments. But as we built and we scale now, we can use that dense, statistically significant pool of data to replicate the models and train new models as we follow essentially the hierarchy of needs from a risk engineering perspective. So now we're able to find what's the next area that we need to improve, and we can do that by what we call activity classification. So we actually will find new job types. And this isn't just a wearable for industrial workers. This is a wearable tailored to the individual. We know when they log in, are they swinging a hammer today? Are they pushing a broom today? Are they driving a truck today? Are they moving packages today? We know what those roles are. We classify their jobs and we deliver the specific insights, and we grow vertically along that pathway. So our goal in 5 years to now is to completely eliminate workplace risk, whether it be industrial or back office. That's where we see that the silly mistakes can be avoided. And technology, as complicated as it is, all we're doing is finding a way to help people be more aware and avoid their own mistakes. And that's where we see our ability to kind of scale and improve many verticals along the pathway for the next decade.
That's fantastic. And I can hear your energy and your voice and passion about the business. So let me take you back a little bit. 2014, I think the business was founded, is that right? Not long ago. Tell me about those early days. I mean, you've done amazing. I mean, obviously, you've talked about us having customers in most of the world at the moment and growing at a phenomenal rate. But tell me, how did it start? How did you put that together? And you must have had a prototype or something and some knockbacks and some challenges. Tell us a little bit about those early days.
Confusing, I think. And the way that we kind of built a solid foundation around that confusion is through experimentation and through essentially hard work and driving true human-centered design with the industrial athletes. And frankly, the way we got through that is just with pure passion. So the reason Strongarm started is I actually grew up working in a family construction company, and I thought that it was going to be my role, but my father passed away in the job. So the business shut down and I went off and became an entrepreneur. And for the last 8 years, I've been trying to figure out this problem. When we started, it was, why don't people care about this? Why is there $3 trillion spent every single year on this issue, and there's not a single human-centered design focused place to go and find solutions to eliminate these? You've got a team of designers at Nike making the next pair of shoes for LeBron James to wear on the court for 3 hours, but nobody putting the same level of intent for somebody who's going to work just as hard 6 days a week for a 40-year career just to put his kid through college. So we 100%. said, let's get people to understand human-centered design in a tangible way and how you can drive true impacts of meaningful productization in an area that is unsexy. So exoskeletons were actually how I did that. So we built two exoskeletons. They were passive. We've sold more exoskeletons by volume than anyone we know of in the world, but it's still a nascent category. And what we found is that when we would go to scale that business, that's where the real challenges are. There's no fundamental way to assess it. And we would build these amazing models in the laboratories and work with leading professionals around the world. But when you go to take it from the lab and into the real world, there is absolutely no way to measure. It's all an observatory science. It's dealt with a static calculation in a dynamic environment. There's Hawthorne effect, observatory biases. Essentially, there's no way to prove the efficacy of the device. And we said, these injuries happen fast. Strong arm needs to be faster. So we built an algorithm that's the most accurate means in the world of predicting a musculoskeletal injury. And then we said, all right, great algorithm. How do we get this thing out into the world? And we looked at about 75 wearables around the world and decided we're just going to have to build our own. One that can scale, one that's easily deployed, one that can manage and keep up with the pace of an industrial athlete. While we were in there, we said, let's just explore all the other pieces of risk. Because what we've just done here now is we've opened up the category from a reactive widget to a proactive assessment tool. And in that mindset, what we've really done is taking the pools of risk, the vision of risk, the way that we view the risk the industrial athlete goes through every single day. And we tie a narrative to everyone in the value chain all the way up to the C-suite. And the reason why is we want them to care, but we don't want to get them to care just on the act of goodwill and saving people. We want them to care because there's real meaning in this deep data that can actually impact your operations. And it's our goal to make that so valuable that you use that to steer your organization. So once we realize that we have the power to do that, and we realize that it's not the fact that the industry doesn't care, it's just the fact that they don't understand, we found that that's when we're going to pivot. And we pivoted the organization out of the exoskeletons into what is now the Fuse risk management platform. And our goal is to take this complex science, deliver insights to eliminate injury, but overall provide insights to how the risk that an industrial athlete faces every day affects everyone in the business and give the tools for everyone to act on.
Have you got, I mean, is there a story that you could share with us where, you know, you've had some feedback from some of the users, some of the people that have perhaps seen the benefits already?
Yeah, that's basically what keeps us coming into work every single day. Right. This is, we've been at this for a little bit and it's a hard industry, right? There's slow cycles. There's, you know, they're in distributed locations and they are such a dynamic and rough environment. We're getting up at 4 a.m, delivering prototypes and then going home and working on them through till 2 a.m. and then getting on an hour of sleep and doing it again, because that's just the pace of the work. Right. Yeah. But what keeps us going are those stories. And we hear stories like, I stopped taking painkillers. Right. I don't go home and drink 6 Budweisers and have a couple Advils and go sleep on the couch. I'm actually playing hockey with my kids, or I have a better relationship with my wife because I'm not grumpy on Monday morning. And there are all sorts of pain stories I can give you and deliver, but really what the biggest impact we have is in the fact that people realize that a simple change can eliminate pain and make your quality of life so much better. And that's really what is our ability to continue to drive and capture those that keeps us going.
Finally, just on that point, I mean, obviously, there's lots of impacts around legality and insurance and claims, of course, and you know that must be driven down as well.
Yeah, absolutely, and that's again back to getting everyone to understand the pieces of this ecosystem that can drive the inequity that's on the industrial athlete back to them, right? So, work comp is a big void. It's a science that's 100 years old, essentially, and the way that it is assessed is not necessarily up to date. Whether it be the timing of the risk, the bucketing of the risk, you know, there's some areas where we've gone into and we were told that the business we're working in, their insurer categorized their warehouse to have 3 job types. We went in, we did our assessment and we found 16 job types. And it's just because the standards are out of whack and they're just not up to date in terms of the nuances of a changing environment. So we're helping deliver and drive insights to inform a greater and overall ecosystem that expands outside of it. Insurance is a very good way to understand where are the lost costs, right? Because of this old science, there's a lot of essentially slack in the business that can be picked up with technology. And what we're driving is true insights, allowing the clients and the insurers to really understand what that risk is. And our belief is that if you can measure it, you can manage it. So for the first time, we're giving them the ability to measure and manage the risk before it even happens and in real time. And we're distributing all of the work that their risk engineering teams could do. So what that means for us is we're offsetting, what it means for them is we're offsetting costs for risk engineering. We're helping driving better insights for premium reduction, or premium retention is really the goal, but we're getting better articulation of risk and creating more defensible products as we go forward. And that's our goal, is to continue to work with the insurers to find the missing pieces of risk and help drive this cost savings there back into the deployments of our equipment so that we can continue to drive better data and insights. And what we're doing is creating a win-win-win. Our goal is to eventually be able to give this system away for free. Got so it. That we're only getting paid on the savings of risk.
Sure, it sounds amazing. It's so exciting. Tell me though, what a typical day in the business looks like for you as a leader. What are you doing every day? What are you up to?
So COVID has been a very polarizing thing as far as a crazy schedule. It's made things quite regimented. So the way the day starts is usually 7:30, 8:30. We're talking to our partners over in your neck of the woods. And then at 9 o'clock every single day, we have a company-wide stand-up. And that's a little arduous, right? You're constantly doing this. We just realized yesterday we've been doing this for 6 months straight, every single day. But the truth is, we keep it light. It's 15 minutes. It lets everyone know that everyone's still alive. We do a little stretch. We have a few jokes, and that's like the best way to kick off the day. So after that, then it's way more meetings than ever because everyone's so much more accessible. So it's meetings throughout the day, a couple of check-ins with the team. And then we now work with our partners in China starting at around 8-9 o'clock at night. And then do it all over again the next day.
I was going to say, try and fit a bit of sleep in between it all. Sounds exciting. So tell me about this. You know, how has your company, how has the business adapted to work from home? What was it like before? What do you see as the challenges and maybe the opportunities that you want to take moving forward? What's your view?
So my view was first and foremost, the safety and the sanity of the team, right? So what are we doing? And that's where the stand-ups came in, the daily cadence. We realized we want you to understand we're still here, we're strong, but also provide a great level of transparency. In this time, you spend a lot of time alone. You don't want folks' thoughts spinning over and over again. So we provided a great level of transparency through the swings of the peak of the virus. And that really was kind of the initial catalyst. And the catalyst that we're getting to is that we pivoted during COVID, and the opportunity for us to drive a truly meaningful product right now in this era has been the most impactful thing for our business. So when we're working remote and it's this terrifying time, we are luckily in a unique position that we were able to, in our own small way, contribute to what these essential workers and these frontline workers were doing in the beginning. Right, we were able to reconfigure some features on our platform that can, one, do social distancing reminders, and two, do contract tracing to provide peace of mind and to also get operations up and running a little bit faster. When things really hit the fan here, we talked to our clients from day one, and we said, how can we be helpful? And first it was deploy remotely, and we were able to do that, right? We were able to completely send things out, update firmware over the air, done. Next thing. How long what is the outlook for COVID on your aspect? Our clients think it's going to be 12 to 18 months, we said. So they need a solution now, but also one that's going to last for a long time. So we started working on that. Our ability to drive and pivot was impressive, and it's just incredible what our team can do. And I think that was one of the more inspiring things. But what was really the best opportunity we received outside of the technical accolades I could deliver for the team is that it gave us all a sense of purpose, right? In our own small way, we're helping these folks go home a little bit safer in a time right now where the whole world is focusing on this. The industrial athletes, the guys in the warehouses have always been our heroes, but at this moment, they are keeping our stock shelved. They're getting medical goods shipped to our hospitals. Like, those are the heroes of the world. And we just felt so lucky to be able to support them in our own small way. And seeing folks like, the leadership and the CEOs starting to actually get down to the ground level in the media and talk to the industrial athletes. Some of the industrial athletes that are actually wearing our stuff, which is really impactful. But to really see the C-suite in these big companies recognizing that work as well. And for us to be a part of that narrative was probably the best thing that could have happened to us as a business during COVID. But in general, what's happening now is that the responsiveness, the cadence for the clients is what's key. Our ability to communicate and drive insights to them is all that matters. And as long as our clients can continue to operate in this way, be accessible, jump on Zoom, have the same person-to-person contact, then truthfully, there's no huge rush to get everyone back in the office. So how can we take advantage of this based on the clients? And that's what we're doing. We're balancing safety first, but second, the other second catalyst is our clients. And some of our clients are going to start going back. Others are going to really adapt to this. So depending on how the world turns out and starts to operate in its own culture, that's where we'll see ourselves fit.
Now, I know you shared a little anecdote, a story from your earlier life and your father passing away. I'm sorry to hear that. Is there anything, though, that from your childhood that may have influenced your work ethic in later life? Any story that you can share with us?
I mean, yeah. My whole family is a bunch of workaholics. So my dad would wake up at 4 in the morning and get the crew ready and go to the construction site. At lunchtime, he would make everyone work out on the roof. So we're doing push-ups and sit-ups to stay awake. And then, that was pretty par for the course. And from a little kid, my goal was, I started out just picking up the trash, but I would have to run trash to trash for 8 hours a day, just stamina, right? My mother's a criminal investigator, and she basically paid for herself through school while she was pregnant and continued to drive her career in her own right because she just wanted to be a criminal investigator and made a career out of it and was actually special agent of the year here in the United States twice in a row. The only woman to ever do
amazing.
So they just work. And my mom's, I can't tell you how old she is because she'll kill me, but she's still out there fighting crime. And the cool thing is that I get to spend time with her a lot now thanks to COVID. And she's still just working 12-hour days. I think that's just how our family was built. My grandfather was an inventor as well, and he worked on the railroad and, grew up in an orphanage. And I think that inventorship and his ability to build everything around him are things that 100% influenced me. But I think at the end of the day, it comes down to just wanting to do what's right and picking up the tools to do it.
You just touched on something there about COVID and some of the good things that have come out of it. Obviously, it's been a travesty for many and impacted so many in a painful way. But what are the things on reflection, just a couple of things that you it might be even the small things that you've really appreciated about that period, this time, that perhaps, has changed you or changed your thinking?
I think trying to find the silver lining, right? And I'd rather spend more time doing that as we face the realities. I mean, we're looking at this disease every day. But it's a couple of things. I think the solitude, one, is helped settle my mind in a lot of ways. Two, it's helped appreciate where you are. But three, it's brought our family, I think, closer together. I think that we have a smaller family and we have more time to spend together, and we're not running around, we're not going to dinners all the time, and we don't have to go entertain folks in the morning and then get on a plane in the afternoon. I think that ability to understand what you can do from a location has been pretty impactful because it's just allowed me to take some time back to appreciate life.
And I think that's Yeah. No, that's fantastic. That's great to hear. It's great to hear. And that's fantastic. What, Sean, just tell me this, what's exciting you right now in the industry? And if you have your crystal ball 12 months to 18 months ahead, what's it going to look like? Do you think what changes might be coming?
Well, it's the great reset, or some might say the great accelerator. I think, I think the only reason some folks call it a reset is because some industries are going to die and others are going to take them over.
For sure.
As an accelerator, I think that there's a couple of factors here. One being remote, people having to be better at technology, being more accessible, is just generally going to accelerate things, which has got me pretty much the most excited out of this whole thing. The other side of it is just that technology, and the reason is just the proliferation of technology in general and the susceptibility of things like wearables and their ability to impact. The reason I'm not the most excited about that is because a lot of people try to do evil things with it. And it's as much of an opportunity for us, and the floodgates have opened. We have never had so much inbound business in the history of the business right now. And it's greatly, and a great part of that is due to the impact of COVID. But there's responsibility with that. And there's going to be a lot of competitors that are going to come out, and they are going to create data that is going to be against the industrial athlete, punitive action. They're going to want to drive robotization. And so as exciting as it is, the technology is available, you still need a business that is has the protection of the data ingrained in their system for the industrial athlete. And that's where it's an exciting challenge, right? Our ability to find data that is a win-win for everyone.
Who's out there in your industry that's sort of chairing that governance and that ethics? Is there some kind of committee out there doing that? No, you're going to be leading it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. If you find our website, we have a safety pledge, and that safety pledge tells us that we will pull the platform back if we find out you're using this data for punitive action against your athletes. And we need companies to do that. And we've scoured. We're in a million different. You know, everything from like CDC requirements to ANSI standards to OSHA standards to ISO standards and all these committees, but no one is actually finding an equitable way to use this data, especially in the advent of Industry 4.0. So we are truly trying to pioneer and drive that. We hope to find more people to join on the bandwagon, because that's a scary position to be in.
No, that's good. What kind of people, Sean, are you looking to connect with, interested in building relationships with?
Folks that are that just truly understand the impacts of data and the ability to drive that into an ecosystem, right? Some folks can understand, yes, that's helpful, but there's other insights where unique data streams need to be folded in. I think as far as we are remote and we can't talk to people and have meaningful coaching moments, we need to look at new ways. And the folks that we want to connect with are those that have an open mindset around that. Safety is our focus, but there's many other things you can drive and the insights that we're collecting. And that's truly what we're looking to do. We're looking to connect with those people who are open about the nuances and open about what happens when we connect the human to our very engaged and technologically advanced Industry 4.0 ecosystem. What happens there? Where are the insights there? And what does that actually mean for our operations? And that's what I want.
Brilliant. Well, final question. If you were giving your 20-year-old self, I know it's not that long ago, 20-year-old self one piece of advice, what would you say to yourself looking back now?
The most important lesson I've learned over time is that an entrepreneur's role is to go and find opportunity, right? And is to bring that opportunity in. And sometimes that opportunity is in the form of advisorship, particularly as you're going through incubators and accelerators. Oftentimes that advisorship is worth the price of admission, which is free. And what happens is there are two types of advisors, right? You get some that are going to drive just general insights, and others are going to drive insights that are somewhat of their input, but not necessarily the best. And what you have to decide and learn as an entrepreneur is that it's in your ability to synthesize that information and deliver that to actionable insights in your own way that makes you unique. And I think it's that confidence of that decision making to say no to some folks, to say yes to others, but to really just come up with an opinion ultimately that it is your own, but it's influenced by the environments you place yourself in, the information, the opportunity you surrounded yourself with, is what makes you the entrepreneur you are. And that's probably the advice that I wish I had when I was 20 years old.
Brilliant. Sean, thank you so much for joining us. I love your energy. And you've got amazing values. I can hear it coming through. It's really good. I wish you so much for the best. If people want to connect with you, find out more about you, connect with the company, what's the best way that they can do that?
Strongarmtech.com.
There you go. Strongarmtech.com. I'll add it on there. Sean, thanks for joining me. Good luck in New York, and we'll speak soon.
Thanks so much.
We really hope you enjoyed the podcast today. If you want to listen to more exclusive tips and life lessons from our guest, go to the resources page at vineresources.com.